Sometimes you just want to start fresh. So in the previous episode, I decided to revamp all my cabling and make proper connectors on all sides, so I would not have to tangle in spaghetti or wires every time I'm trying to run the motor. The cable and the connector for the resolver worked out pretty well, until I reached the stumbling point with the throttle pedal connector, which wouldn't fit. The whole thing has reached an anticlimax at the point when I was trying to glue an amp seal connector. Now the glue has dried up and our connector and the PCB very securely attached to the cover. However, of course we do have a problem. The plan was that the connector could be fitted at an angle. I made the measurements while inserting a board from the inside of the inverter and the connector from the outside. It appears that the walls of the inverter are not the same thickness. While I was making measurement at the top, the thickness at the bottom is slightly bigger. So now I'm facing a problem where the glued connector doesn't fit. So this corner here is not clearing this inverter. Right, so back to the drawing board. I think I want to cut this off a little bit until I can reach at least the track here and maybe tidy up this a bit as well. I wish I'd done it before I glued it in, but I was hoping that it will fit. I decided to make further cuts on the edges and corners of the PCB and scrape some of the glue in some areas. Having done this, I can just squeeze the connector in if I apply a bit of force. Okay, I've discovered that when I was installing the connector, I think I may have damaged one of the tracks. Well, I am quite confident I have. So it's pin number 10. So this part of the track is connected, but the actual pin on IDC connector isn't. And I think the damage is one of the, just here at the bottom. So unfortunately, I will need to solder the link in this part. Okay, I managed to repair one of the wires I damaged, so I just put in the link here. Still, however, I can fit it in with the force, but it doesn't fit in very easily. After a few adjustments, connector was fitted securely, so I could proceed with the final installation and fixing the connector with the screws. Now we can fit the cable. Yep, the cable went well, and this will go into the inverter. And this is how it will look from the outside, except this little cover will be glued on top with a lot of epoxy around to completely seal it from the weather. Having made the cable for the amp seal connector, resolver and the throttle pedal, I've decided that I will need to test how it works, because basically I will almost likely expect that making so many changes, I probably made a mistake somewhere. Let's give it a test and see how it's working. So this is my new setup. Just switching the power supply and enabling the power. At the same time, this is the high voltage. And this is the control box. So first I switch on the power to the inverter and the pre-charge contactor activated, and now I'm pressing the start button, which basically turned off the pre-charge and switched on the main contactor. Just to show you the cable, so this is the old cable there, and this is the new cables and a new amp seal connector. This cable goes to the resolver and this cable goes to the throttle pedal. Now we're gonna give it a try and see if it works. Okay, and it doesn't work. Oh, bummer. As I expected, there is a problem somewhere. I've checked all the cables, and actually it turns out to be that the fault is quite simple. It turns out to be the culprit was this connector, which I didn't plug in properly. So yeah, I've reconnected the connector and it works now. So this is my throttle pedal with a new cable. And so yeah, it does work quite well, didn't really affect any other things, so everything else is correct. I will need to have another contactor in here. As you could see, there is not much space left in this box. Instead of this, I decided to get this. It's quite a bit of an upgrade. It looks to me it's almost like 70% of the inverter volume. But that will give me plenty of space to put additional contactors and high voltage connections. So let's crack on. I took some pictures and made some reference notes about my original connectors to make sure I know how to go back where I was, and swiftly disassembled the project box. As a next step, I used isolation tape and loom tape to get wires assembled in a nice tidy cable that will go from arm seal connector to the contactor box. This is our junction box, which we're going to be using as our contactor box. So I cut out a little board, so that would be the base for all our contactors and connections, etc. Now we're just going to screw it in. Okay, this is now fixed. It's another one. It's quite handy because this board has sort of drill locations. I think it was used for drilling PCBs, and it actually helps to mount things on it. Now I can mount the contactors, and this is our pre-charge contactor.
Once contactors were installed, I progressed with feeding the wires through the isolated glands. First, I started with wiring the 12 volts coming from the external power supply, and progress with connecting the inverter 12 volts and forward and reverse signal, as well as the other signals for the inverter start button and the power on switch. Having done all that, I thought it might be a good idea to test the contactors, just to make sure they still work correctly. First, when I power on the inverter, the pre-charge contactor switched on, while the main contactor still remains open circuit. After I press the start button, the pre-charge contactor gets disengaged and main contactor gets engaged. So the pre-charge cycle is finished and inverter capacitors are charged. And now I can test the whole thing. I can wire my test high voltage connection and go through the pre-charge cycle again. But this time I get to really spin the motor and use the throttle pedal to get our motor up and running.
And now I've tested it and it works. So just to show you,